Hello everyone, in this video we are going to discuss that why do we need different types of data representation with the help of some examples. So as a human being, we know only the decimal number system, okay, and we are comfortable with that, but the computer does not understand the decimal number system that we use in our daily life. So let's discuss what is the need of the data representation as such. As I told you, since our childhood, as a human being, we are interested or we are comfortable with the decimal numbers. So for example, we write 10, 200, minus 50. So all these numbers are in the decimal number system. Okay. But when we give these numbers or the data in form of these decimal numbers to your computer, then computer does not understand these decimal numbers. Computer understands only one type of numbers, that is binary numbers. So binary numbers are the numbers which consist of only two things, that is two bits, 0 and 1. So all the numbers, they are made by the composition or the combination of these 0, 1 in binary number system. So computer is comfortable or computer understand all the informations, all the data in form of binary numbers. So here comes the need to understand this type of other data representation, that is binary number system, that how we can understand the numbers or how we can write the decimal numbers in binary number. Now it is not easy to understand or to read the binary numbers. So when there are many group of bits consisting of 1010 combinations, the data that has been converted from decimal to binary. So this numbers or this data is not easy to be understood by the human being. So for the easy representation or for the easy understanding of this binary number, we have another data representations. We have octal number system and we have the hexadecimal number system for the easy understanding of this binary numbers. So here comes the need that how to represent your binary number in octal and the hexadecimal number systems. Okay. Now, if we talk about our programming languages, then when we are making the programs in any of the language, we give some data in our code. Okay. So the data that we will be giving, that can consist of positive numbers as well as negative numbers. Okay. So here comes the need to understand that how positive numbers and negative numbers are internally represented in your computer. Why? Because the source code that you are writing in your any programming language, that is going to be understood at last by your computer. So how the things are getting represented inside the computer. So you will say, okay, I will just make the program and it is the responsibility of the computer to understand or to interpret that information. I am just interested in the output as a human being. So why should I understand these positive, negative numbers, how these are represented inside the computer? I need not to worry. So the real problem comes when you have to answer such type of questions. For example, this is the line which is written inside the C language. And this line says unsigned short int a, and this variable is holding this value. Okay. So let's assume inside the C language, if you are familiar with the C language, this unsigned short int is of 2 bytes. Okay. So if I ask you what will be the output coming inside this A variable, so many of you can say that on printing A, you will get 65537. But the answer is no. You will not get 65537 on printing this A variable. You will actually get 1 on printing this A variable. Okay. So what is the reason behind this? So to understand this, you should know that how the data inside A variable is going. So here comes the need to understand the signed, unsigned representation of the data. So here you should know how the positive and negative numbers are actually represented inside the computer. Then you can easily answer such type of questions. And in real life, inside the computers, negative numbers have different types of representation. The popular ones are three representations like 1's complement, 2's complement and sign magnitude representation. Now, if we talk about the digital circuits, then all the digital circuits which are going to be used in our computer or in any of the embedded device, they all are going to be understanding the language of the zeros and ones. Okay, that's why they are called the digital circuits. So you should understand when we give the data in form of zeros and one, how these circuits will be interpreting those informations. So at that time, you should know that how our data given by the human being is going to be represented and how it is going to be read by your digital circuits. Okay, so here different data manipulation technique you should understand, which is related to actually data representation. Now, if you talk about the assembly programming, so let's suppose you are having a high level language program written inside, let's say, C language, and you convert this with the help of a compiler into your assembly program. So, you know, in assembly program, you will be having some mnemonics, for example, add, subtract, and so on. Other than that, the data that you have written inside your high level language, for example, any numbers 200 or minus 500 and so on, any numbers or any data that you are writing in high level language program, it will be getting converted to some representation inside the assembly programming. Now, if you are working in a company where your task is to understand this assembly language program and you are not given this high level language program, then to get a good understanding or a deep understanding of this assembly program, you should understand the representation of the data which is written inside the assembly programming. So here you can see you have like C, 000, 8E and so on. So there are many other numbers which are not actually the decimal numbers. So you should know that what actually these numbers or what does this data actually means to get an understanding of this assembly programming. So this is one of the other example which says that why we should understand the data representations. So let's take one last example. So this example is related to your floating numbers. So let's suppose you are having this program float a equal to 0.1 and you are printing this number, that is a variable, okay, and this is in the C programming, let's say. So if I ask you what will be the answer coming inside this a variable, so you will simply say the answer will 0.1. it is not a big deal. But the thing is, in many of the computer you will not get 0.1. you may get, for example, 0.99 on printing this a variable using this printf line, or you may get, for example, 1.0064 something this answer. That means you will not get the exact representation of the 0.1. that is, you will not get 0.1. sometime you may get, but it is not guaranteed. So what is the reason behind this, that we are not getting exactly 0.1 on printing our a variable? So for this you should understand that how this 0.1 is actually installed inside your computer. That means you should understand how the floating numbers are actually stored inside your computer. The same way, if I ask you what will be the answer in this a variable on printing, so if you are adding 0.6 plus 0.3, so in maths you will get 0.9. that means inside a 0.9 will come. So your 0.9 should be printed as the output, but you may not get 0.9 as the answer in your C programming. For example, you may get 0.8999 and so on, or you may get some answer which is nearby to this answer, but you may not get the answer which is exactly 0.9. so again, here you should understand that how the floating point numbers are actually stored inside your computer to answer such type of questions. Now, as you can see here the image, so this image when stored in the computer, it is actually stored in form of zeros and one, or more specifically we can say, like as you have heard, that image is stored in form of pixels, right? Small rectangles. So those small rectangles are also the group of zeros and one internally. So the whole image is stored in form of zeros and ones. So to understand this image better, or to understand the pixels better, you should know how that particular pixel is represented in form of zeros and ones. Okay, so you should know that how the data is represented in form of zeros and ones to represent this particular image inside the computer. Now, if we take the example of our internet, then we can see many machines are connected via the internet. Or let's say we are transmitting the data to a particular machine, or we are taking the data from a particular machine. So during this data transmission, there can be many errors while transmitting the data, right? So to check whether the data that has been transmitted to a particular location, or whether the data that has been come to our computer, it is error free or not, okay? So for this error correction and detection, we have many mechanisms. For example, we have the parity concept, we have the CRC, that is cyclic redundancy check. These are some of the methods that are used in the data communications to check the error correction and the error detection. So to understand these methods or the other methods of the error correction detection, we should know that how the data is actually represented in binary. Because CRC, if you talk about, then CRC do the division operations on the binary number for its process. Okay, so you should know that how the data is represented in form of binary, or how the various arithmetic operations are performed on the binary data. I hope now you have got a better idea that why we should understand the different representation techniques of the data in form of binary, and why the number system and the arithmetic operations on the binary data should be studied. So now what I will be discussing in the next upcoming videos. So this is my roadmap, or the things that I'm going to discuss in the upcoming videos related to your data representations. So I'll discuss what are unsigned and the signed numbers, and I will also discuss why do we need them. Then I will discuss what are the various number systems and the conversion between them. Then we will discuss how the unsigned numbers arithmetic is done. That is how the addition subtraction operations are done, and what do you mean by the overflow in them. Then we will discuss that how the negative numbers are actually inserted inside your computer. Okay, so we will discuss about sign magnitude, ones complement and twos complement during that time. Okay, and after that, as we have discussed the addition subtraction of the unsigned number, the same way we will discuss the addition subtraction of the negative numbers also. Okay, and after that we will discuss that why there are actually three different representations for the negative numbers, and what are the advantage and disadvantage of all those three approaches. Okay, at last we will discuss the different representation techniques for the floating numbers. For example, you are having, let's say, 0.89, such type of floating point numbers, or 1.873, so such type of floating point numbers have different representations. So we have fixed point representation and IEEE 754 representation. So this IEEE 754 is very much important, because this is asked in many of the competitive exams like GATE, UGCNET and so on. So we will discuss all these things, and during discussion of all these things, we will take many examples to understand this concept better. So we will take mostly GATE questions or the other UGCNET and other related questions to discuss all these things in a better way. So I believe now you have got a better idea that why we should discuss the data representation and what is the need to understand them. So stay tuned for the next upcoming videos. If you have not subscribed my channel, please subscribe my channel and press the bell icon for further notifications. So let's see you in the next video. Till then, goodbye.